Two gas station attendants are murdered. A 17-year-old drifter confesses to the crime. For which he is accused. And it shows that sometimes protecting the procedures of the law . 8 years. Michael Pardue embraces his wife, Becky, whom he married.
Free then.
This was no ordinary release. The man, with the help of his wife, it began May 22nd, 1973, in Mobile, Donald Ryder. The station had been robbed, and Ryder shot in the head at close range. Had also been hit. The attendant there was Hodges also had been killed by a shotgun blast to the head.
Shot the dude on. No, it's just, I know I didn't pull the trigger on purpose. And it's a little grand larceny or burglary or something. You know?
And then you notice the name of the station.
Yes, and it's Bay. And then it went off. And I didn't pull the triggers intentionally. The thing just went off. And then finally, you know, I'm standing there and I still got a shotgun in one hand, my right hand.
When the police mentioned murder, he claims it sounded so bizarre, he figured he could.
I know I ain't shot nobody, you know.
Considered him a good suspect. At 17 years old, Pardue was marriage gone bad.
My father was a very violent alcoholic. He's kind of relaxed, you know? No.
Those were her last words. She died before reaching the hospital.
Was virtually an orphan with his mother dead and his father in prison and a dysfunctional family, to say that.
1973. According to Pardue, on that night he was, as usual, up to no good.
I walk in, my grandmother, she said, "Where's your car?" First thing I remember.
Lie. So he called the Saraland police to report that his Chevy was missing. It quickly turned
Nobody's treating me like anything other than a kid. Then a sergeant walked. Favor my father physically in the way he looks, the way he dressed, and murderer blows head off. You're a tough man, you're evil, you're psycho.
Well, now, I shouldn't be getting any real problem. I mean, they need to let me in to see him and what I was intending. Well, you could tell that it was a serious case and that they were taking it dead serious.
Pardue says sometime on the fourth day, he finally broke down and confessed.
And then I was like, man, where in the hell, what am I doing up here, you know? Well, I looked down at the man, and instead of seeing a man's face, because I knew I'd just killed a man,
Pardue says all of it occurred when the tape was off. The teenager was confronted with some.
Ready to confess to killing anybody, Abraham Lincoln or John.
In April 2000, Brown claimed the detectives, one of them in particular, treated him.
And I just felt like
he now says the reason is simple. No one would have believed him. While Saraland police do not flat out.
For the slaying of Ronald Ryder. He recalls that his first meeting with his attorney did. Girl whom Pardue admitted he had been with the night of the murders. She said both Pardue and for his part, Pardue's defense attorney failed to question the integrity of the interrogation.
Their case was so strong they just didn't look for it. Back then they had an eyewitness and a confession. Who needs forensics?
Problems in how the case was handled.
When you get a situation where you have a transcript,
still faced charges on two more murders in Mobile County. At that point, the district attorney the U.S. Supreme Court had invalidated all the country's death penalty laws in 1972. Even so, for the family of one of the murdered gas station attendants, the convictions seemed fair. His alleged accomplice in the killings, John Brown, was convicted of
eat me alive.
He not only survived, prison gave his life a where he volunteered to train dogs used to catch escapees. His job was Mobile Hospital.
He's a good con man. He can talk. And he was always able to
reach the guard's keys and make his escape. He borrowed a car from a friend.
license plate, and he just says, "This does not look right. There's something wrong with that picture."
As a model inmate, he began working on the cattle ranch at Atmore Prison.
A triple killer. Well, this would be pretty interesting. You know, let's look a little closer.
I'd found peace there.
Now I have got an incentive to get out of here that I never had.
Legally.
He's the strong, silent type. He has a very soft voice.
I've suddenly understood they tasted like crap because with
he was a triple murderer, yet he had minimum custody. We were allowed to take 8-hour passes away from the prison.
The warden's gun and the car keys, and he got in the Corvette.
Now, it turned out that he had simply gone to his father's home.
sentence of life in prison without the possibility of parole and without Becky. Using the same legal system that put Pardue behind bars to try to get him out. For almost all of his appeals. Then in 1994, they found an issue a judge would. The point. The U.S. Supreme Court guarantees every individual the right to a vigorous defense. Together.
We went through several shotguns trying to find the one. We couldn't find it.
Through it box by box, looking to see if they could find anything. And they came upon a file that had the reel-to-reel and the photograph.
Of the murders.
I'm standing there and I still got a shotgun in one hand, my right hand.
In court, the defense. Who was 17 at the time of the murders, was in no position to withstand any kind of sustained assault.
Did it.
You hadn't had any problem with any officers?
No.
Trying to harass you or threaten.
showing in that courtroom except that tape confession. I said, I don't know, it's just something fishy about this.
And the most crucial evidence against him. But it was the part of the confession that wasn't on the tape. Attorneys immediately appealed, arguing that the critical piece of evidence against him, his confession,
the right to stop answering many times. No promises, threats, or inducements have been made against me, and no
before he was interrogated. In August 1996, Pardue's for any of the murders.
That's the judicial system in our country.
In a hearing before the court, the prosecutor reminded the judge of this fact.
We're really very, very grateful that the state of Alabama is so inefficient that they cannot
and when the judge finishes reading his sentence, he gets up and leaves the bench, and the guard
by the state of Alabama.
Prison officials explained that there was still paperwork to be done before
bizarre. And I looked around, I saw Michael. He had all his possessions and a small
Michael Pardue says he now plans to live quietly with his wife. Today, those
I have no doubt of that in my mind. He has had the benefit of every
As long as Michael Pardue acted like a thug and escaped and broke the law, he was have happened.
Michael Pardue and his two alleged accomplices remain the only people technicality. But Pardue's story illustrates a key principle in American justice. When it is